So, thanks for the introduction and welcome to my talk. So, I'm a PhD student at the Institute of Applied Physics and the Zoological Institute, both at the Karlsruhe Institute of Technology in Germany. And yeah, the presentation today is about controlling the shape of 3D microstructures by temperature and light, which is going through the direction of stimuli-responsive microstructures. So in comparison of most of the previous talks, we are now talking about the micrometer regime, so really small structures. And here on the title slide, you can already see the approach that we are using, which is based on two different materials. So I'm using a bimaterial design, as the a previous speaker was already introducing. But I use it now in the context of different materials. And I will explain this on the next couple of slides too. So first, I would like to introduce the material we use. So I use a stimuli-responsive polymer, but not a shape memory polymer. But I use a material called isopropyl NIPAM, which is more probably the most well-known stimuli-responsive polymer, and it's very well studied. It has a thermal response. That means it reacts to changes in temperature. And if you make a polymer network out of it, this is shown in the scheme here on the right side, you have a structure like this with a poly-NIPAM network. And this structure is hydrophilic at room temperature. So this means it will take up a lot of water and it will swell with this water. And you get a hydrogel with a water content of 70 to 90%. And what's very interesting about this material is that it has a lower critical solution temperature of about 32 degrees Celsius. And if you go above this temperature, the material characteristics drastically change. Namely, the material goes from a hydrophilic state to a hydrophobic state. That means it repels water. As a result, the water will go outside of the system and the material and thus the polymer network will shrink significantly. And there are three nice things about this this principle here. First of all, this response is really strong, as I will show you on the next slide. So you get a quite significant change between these two phases. The second one is that this process is completely reversible. So if you cool your sample back down, so and go in this direction, the material will become hydrophilic again and swell again with water and thus expand. And the third aspect, which is mainly the reason why it has been so so well studied, is that this transition temperature is around 32 degrees Celsius, which is in a physiological regime regarding biological and medicine, and very close to the body temperature of 37 degrees. So I will basically skip everything regarding how we make this material into a photoresist or an ink and directly show you what kind of technique we use. So we use a technique called 3D laser lithography or direct laser writing. This is the same technique that was introduced by the speaker previously with the thermal response beams. But I will quickly show you a movie of how this works. So we have a glass slide here on the bottom and a liquid photoresist on top. And we focus a femtosecond pulsed laser beam into this liquid photoresist. And due to the non-linearity of this process and the threshold behavior of this resist, we only polymerize the material in the very focus of this laser beam. And we can move this laser beam around in an arbitrary manner and thus create any three-dimensional structure that we want as long as it's attached to the substrate. And when we are finished, we just remove the residual photoresist and we end up with the structures on our sample. So this is the basic principle of this technique I will use in all these experiments here. So in the first step, I want to convince you that these characteristics I showed you in the scheme at the beginning are really what's going on. So in the first step, we did something very simple. We just fabricated a block that you can see in this image here on the left-hand side out of this poly-NIPAM material. And we characterized it via atomic force microscopy. In the first step, we had a look at the volume. So here you can see the cantilever. And what we did is we performed a line scan from the glass surface, so here around the block, on top of the block. And you can see this here on the right side, we have the height as a function of the line scan position. So here we are at the glass surface, so basically at zero. And then we move on top of the block, so you can see that the block has a height about 3 microns. And this is measured at room temperature. So what happens now if we increase the temperature to 45 degrees, so well above this lower critical solution temperature, the block shrinks significantly by more than a factor of 3 from 3 to about 1 micrometer. So this is a really significant change of the material properties. And the nice thing is if we cool it down again, we are able to restore the initial value quite well. And you can repeat this process multiple times, so heat it up, cool it down again, and you will change between these two phases very nicely. So this is a completely reversible process. The next thing I will show you is that not only the volume changes, but also the material characteristics and especially the mechanical properties. Because when the network gets more compact, it will also get stiffer as a result, because more crosslinks are denser together. So what we did is we again used atomic force microscopy to measure the stiffness inside of this dashed line here, and we record the Young's modulus as a function of the temperature. And this is a logarithmic scale here. So first of all, we start at room temperature. If you look at these red dots here, and we increase the temperature, and you will see that around this lower critical solution temperature, the stiffness increases drastically from about 10 to 20 kilopascal at the beginning up to 200 to 300 kilopascal above this lower critical solution temperature. And then if you follow the blue points back, if we cool the sample back down, we follow exactly this trend, and within measurement errors, we end up at the initial value. So you can not only change the volume, but also the mechanical properties change drastically of this material. So what can we do with that? So we want actually to have some actuation, some sort of defined bending. This is typically what's required for soft robotics applications, or also if you want to have a directed actuation. And we employ a system that has already been introduced by a previous speaker, which is the bimaterial design. So here you can see a top view of this scheme. So we basically have a post here, which is attached to this beam. And this beam has two sides, a green one and a gray one, which is representative for two different materials, basically. And the idea is that the green one has a very large responsivity, so it responds very strongly to changes in temperature, whereas the gray one has a very weak responsivity, so it does not change a lot when you change the temperature. And what happens if you increase the temperature for this kind of schematic structure here, the left side shrinks significantly if we talk about this polynipam material I was just introducing, and it pulls the whole beam to the left-hand side. Now, if you want to fabricate something like this with multiple materials, as we just discussed in the previous session, this might get very complicated, especially for the technique we are using, because it's not possible to have multiple materials at the same time. So the only option you are left with is a sequential fabrication process, and this is either really complicated or limits your design options a lot. So we chose a different route, which is called Cratone lithography. And here the basic idea is that you can change the material properties by changing the exposure dose, which is a principle that was also already introduced by the previous speaker, but it has far more consequences for the system I will show you here. Because previously only the thermal expansion coefficient changed, but now I work with a stimuli responsive polymer, and I will show you that I can just adjust the responsivity, so how the polymer reacts to this external stimulus. And the basic idea is that you change the exposure dose, and in my case, I will show here the laser power that we use during the fabrication. And this is a process that can change basically for every voxel in the system. I can set a different laser power during this fabrication process. And in our system, this has a huge impact, because if you put more exposure dose into your system, you create more crosslinks, and these crosslinks make the network stiffer and more compact. And if the network has more crosslinks in it, it can no longer expand and shrink in the same way than if you have less crosslinks. And this is the basic mechanism how we can adjust with the laser power how the system responds to the external trigger. And I will show you this in this graph here. So what we did is we fabricated beams, as are shown on the left side here, with two parts, a left and a right one. You cannot distinguish them on these images here, but you have to believe me, they are there. The right gray beam was always fabricated with a laser power of 40 milliwatt, but for the left one, so the green beam, we used the laser power from 40 to 30 milliwatt. And if you look at the first structure here at room temperature and then at elevated temperatures, you might see a small isotropic shrinkage, but you definitely see no bending. However, if you make the difference between the laser powers larger and larger, you will see that a more and more pronounced bending to the left-hand side occurs. So this is the basic principle how we fabricate these structures. So this is basically just a 3D view of what I was just explaining you. So in the back, you can again see the model for the two temperature states. And now in front, you can see a 3D reconstruction, which we measured via laser scanning fluorescence microscopy. So basically, we just added a fluorescent dye in the system and took an image at room temperature and took an image at 45 degrees. And you can nicely see the strong bending to the left-hand side. So in the first step, I will want to show you a few characterization of these structures. So here again, you can see a top view of these structures. And I will now show you a movie for basically images which show different temperature points. And at the same time, I will show you here the curvature as a function of the temperature. And you will see that if we increase the temperature, this beam bends more and more and more, and especially the bending changes strong around this transition temperature of 32 to 36 degrees Celsius. And you can see a really significant bending of, let's say 180 degrees, if you want to call it that. So you might ask yourself whether this process or this fabrication procedure is robust. So I will show you this movie here on the top right. It basically shows 3x3 nominally identical structures on the same substrate. And I will also again change the temperature from room temperature to 45 degrees, and you will see that all of them respond in the same way. So they really all show the same response that I was explaining you previously. And if you look at the bottom graph here, we evaluated the curvature of all of these beams for multiple cycles of stimulation. So we heated it up, cooled it down, heated it up, and so forth. And you can see that within measurement errors over 12 cycles, we see no deterioration at all. So this process is completely reversible. And of course, we could have gone on here, but at some point, this whole process just gets boring. So we stopped after 12. So the next thing I want to show you is how does the geometrical aspects or the design considerations impact this behavior. And if you think about bimetallic stripes, maybe from school, that this is something very typical, that the aspect ratio has a huge influence. So I will just also again show you a movie for different beam lengths from 30 to 60 microns. You see that they all show this nice bending behavior, and some of them even bend so much that they touch the central pillar already. And here on the right side, this is an even more extreme case. This is a beam which is 120 microns long, and I will now show you the reverse case. So we go from 45 degrees Celsius and cool it back down. And you will see that in this state, it's completely curled up. And if we now cool it down again, you will see that it unfolds and really goes back into its initial shape quite nice. So again, showing you that this is a reversible process that we are seeing here. So I told you at the beginning that we are able to really define the material parameters for every point. So I want to show you this with some more complex structures than just two materials, left and right. And I want to show you how we can use numerical calculations to predict this behavior. So in the first step, what we did is we looked at the experimental results for some given geometry and material parameters, and we chose the input parameters for our model in such a way that the theoretical model resembles what we see in the experiment. So this is easy because you can just adapt the input parameters. But at this point, we fixed the parameters and looked at more complex situations. So what happens if we change the segments multiple times during a beam? For example, here, the left side on the bottom is fabricated with a low exposure dose, but on the top, the right side is fabricated with a low exposure dose. So we can fabricate these structures. You can see them here on the left side. You might make out the individual segments here because the contrast is a little bit different. But apart from that, they all look straight. And then we had a look at the numerical calculations, and this is the result. So the bottom part here is expected to bend to the left side and the top part to the right side. And if we look at the experimental results, this is exactly what we can observe. So with this method, we are able to control the material parameters locally very well. And with these numerical calculations, we are even able to predict the behavior. So far, everything I showed you was the stimulation via temperature, but on the title, there was also the name light. So I will now show you how it's possible to not only address all of the structures, if you, for example, change the temperature of the water bath of your sample, but also how it's possible to address individual structures via stimulation of focused laser light. And in this movie here, you will see how we illuminate one of these structures here with a focused laser beam. And only this illuminated structure will show a significant response to the light illumination. The structures which are 100 micrometers apart to the left and right-hand side will show a small response if you look closely, but it's really insignificant compared to the one where you illuminate. So what is going on here? We still have a thermal response of polymer. So we again used some numerical calculations to inspect the underlying mechanisms. And here you can now see a temperature profile with a false color scale on the bottom. And if we illuminate the central structure, what actually happens is we absorb the light, we generate heat, and this heat is sufficient to trigger the response around the central beam structure, but not sufficient to give a significant response for the structures which are 100 microns apart. So this gives you a powerful tool because you can not only address all structures, but focus your response to individual structures on the substrate. So with this, I would like to come to my summary slide. I hope that I convinced you that we have an interesting material here and that we characterized the material properties, basically the volume change and the stiffness change. We made use of this gray tone lithography approach to change the material parameters in the one-step fabrication procedure by adjusting the exposure dose. I showed you some numerical calculations, which enables us to predict even complex responses of our structures. And I showed you how we can use light as a stimulus to control individual structures on some substrate. And with this, I would like to leave you with this small movie on the bottom right, thank our funding agencies, and thank you for your attention.
Okay, thank you very much, Mark, for your presentation, your very clear presentation about how this works. As being not a researcher myself, by far not a researcher myself, I'm always looking at the, let's say, the application area. So I suppose you have done this, started this project with some ideas about what the applications could or would be with what you have now, let's say, shown as a result. Could you elaborate a bit on that?
Yes. So basically, it's not, let's say, we have not finished the project in terms of the application, but there are some things that we have in mind that would be possible. So one thing I can maybe show you a preliminary result here is if you think about microfluidics, you could think of something like this. This was mentioned in a previous talk already. These are 3D reconstructions. So here you would have a microfluidic valve and this responsive material on the inside, and by changing the material, you can the temperature, you can basically change the opening of this area in the center, so you can control how much liquid can go through this this tube basically. So this would be in the direction of microfluidics. And if you think about soft robotics more, I could show you something like this, which is basically a playing example of building a microthermometer, an analog microthermometer on the microscale. So this is just one of these beams which points to the temperature of the water bath around it, because the response is so predictable and so robust that we can actually just write the numbers on the substrate with this direct laser writing technique. And by looking at the beam, it will show you what the temperature of the water bath is. And maybe a more actually useful example goes into the direction of grippers, which is always something that soft robotics people show. Basically putting two of these bimaterial beams next to each other, you can make some sort of gripper, which maybe can trap some particles or activate some things as a function of the temperature.